Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Peter Swendsen, and I'm joined here for this episode of Oberlin's Stage Left by my friends and colleagues, Aurie Hsu and Tom Lopez. We three are all Oberlin alumni and currently faculty members in the Technology in Music and Related Arts Department at the Oberlin Conservatory of Music. We're here to share some of our recent creative work and in particular, some of our collaborations with dance. These projects cross a broad range of movement styles, sound worlds, collaborative approaches, and they include combinations of modern dance, flamenco dance, contemporary belly dance, acoustic and electroacoustic music, robotic instruments, and collaborations with alumni and faculty from the Oberlin Dance Department, along with choreographers from Los Angeles, Austin, Washington, D.C., and dance companies such as Give Me Dance in New York City and Cleveland's Groundworks Dance Theater. We're keeping the excerpts short and sweet, 2 or 3 minutes each, but in most cases, the full pieces are available on our websites and elsewhere online. And if you stay tuned to the end of the episode, there'll be credits featuring all of the choreographers, dancers, and musicians who appear in these excerpts. Aurie?
Hi, my name is Aurie Hsu, and I teach in TIMARA. And my main dance experience is performing with a sensor-based system that allows me to control sound. But I also very much enjoy collaborating with choreographers and dancers and musicians to create pieces for movement and sound. Tom?
Hello, everybody. My name is Tom Lopez. I'm currently the chair of the TIMARA department, and I've been teaching here since 1999. I'm particularly excited about this episode because collaborating with choreographers has been a central part of my artistic practice from the very beginning. And it's been an important part of my development as an artist and taught me a lot about composing with time and also utilizing space, because of course dancers are in physical spaces, but then our expertise in TIMARA also includes using multiple speakers and projecting sound in three dimensions. So I'm very happy to be able to share some of my work and the awesome work of my colleagues with you. I'm really happy to share an excerpt from a piece entitled Inflatable Trio. I collaborated with Los Angeles-based choreographer Lionel Popkin and two of the dancers in his company. It was a super fun and rewarding process. A striking aspect of the performance were these inflatable pieces of furniture. They were used in a variety of ways throughout the piece. And just prior to the excerpt that I'll share with you, the soloist, Samantha Moore, throws a fit and kicks and hurls the furniture all around the stage. It's really a spectacular sequence. And then she collapses in exhaustion, and the other two dancers collect the furniture and pile it up on top of her. The solo picks up from there as she slides out from under the pile of inflatable furniture. Thank you.
This excerpt from Why Should Our Bodies End at the Skin from 2018 for sensor-equipped dancer, robotic percussion, sound exciters, and live sound processing is a collaboration with composer Stephen Kemper. The title comes from Donna Haraway's 1984 essay, A Cyborg Manifesto. In thinking about the role of technology in our lives, Haraway asks if we, humans, can have a kinship with technology rather than a fear of technological singularity. This piece explores hybrid bodies in performance and fluidity between organism and machine. In this piece, I am wearing the ROCK system, the remote electroacoustic kinesthetic sensing system that we created to control the sound with my movement. And in this excerpt, you'll see a duet between myself and the robotic percussion, which is called Caddy, the configurable automatic percussion instrument. In the middle of the excerpt, I start controlling the timbres of the noisy texture, and then at the end, I move into playing directly with the robotic drums, metaphorically connecting organism and machine.
Wow. Ari, you are an amazing, multi-talented artist, and there's so much, I mean, we could dedicate a whole half hour conversation just to this one piece, I think. But one thing that strikes me is that you've had training as a musician and as a composer, as a dancer, a choreographer. And with that context, when I think about this piece and all the themes and issues and technology that you're exploring, I wonder how you conceive of sort of the percussion on stage with you. Because you can control it with your body, do you think of it as an extension of yourself? Is it an extension of sound? Is it an extension of physical gesture? Or is the percussion more like having another performer on stage? Like, in other words, is it a solo performance where you control everything, physical and musical? Or is it a duet where you perform with a virtual performer?
I love that question. My answer would be, it at different times of the piece, it's a little bit of each. And the background behind the interaction between movement and the robotic instruments comes from this Middle Eastern practice of the drum solo, which usually features a virtuosic dancer and a virtuosic drummer. And when it's done at its best, you don't know who's leading and you don't know who's following. And those roles can pivot at any given second. And so sometimes I'm dancing to the drums. So the drums, you know, have a pre-programmed rhythm that I dance to. And then sometimes I control them, in which case we're kind of one and the same. The body is the instrument and they're tightly integrated. And sometimes the drums have minds of their own and they face me and start doing something that I have to respond to. So it's a little bit of each at different parts of the piece.
Thank you.
This piece is one that has a long history. It's a piece called Coldness and Lightness that I co-created with a longtime collaborator, Ashley Thorndike. Ashley and I, along with another dear friend, Dinah Gray, had a dance company together in Charlottesville, Virginia for several years, and we've been making work together since 2003. We made the first version of this piece, Coldness and Lightness, here in Oberlin in 2009, and then had the opportunity to extend it and remount it in Washington, D.C. in 2017, at which point we were invited to perform it at the Kennedy Center's Millennium Stage in the spring of 2019. And this is now an evening-length piece. It explores tensions between stability and instability, between awe and joy and melancholy. The excerpt that you'll see here with Candace Scarborough dancing as the featured soloist before she's joined by some others comes from the middle of the piece. And it teases out some of these forces that are at work throughout, explorations of stillness, time, sensation of space and landscape, very big open spaces, very intimate personal spaces, and the juxtapositions of suspension and action.
this excerpt is from a piece called Media Solo, which was choreographed by Rose Beauchamp, who is based in Rochester, New York, and Alicia Woodruff, who is based in Salt Lake City, Utah. They were exploring how protest is portrayed in the media and asked me to mirror these images sonically. So to mirror these themes, I created collages of sounds, including overlapping static, buzzy guitar samples, noisy and glitchy elements, and machinery sounds. There are also rhythmic textures and layers that create continuous activity with very little repose and relief. The excerpt ends with dancers in and around a box to try to evoke also that sensation of being claustrophobic and being hemmed in by some of these portrayals.
Okay, so Peter, counterpoint is a term that we frequently use in music, and choreographers also use it when describing the relationships between various physical movements and between dancers. But I think there is also a counterpoint between movement and sound, and counterpoint between dance and music. So I'm curious, in this piece, Luna, were you thinking about counterpoint while you were collaborating with David Shimotakahara?
Yeah, for sure. And I think David's work often addresses contrapuntal compositional techniques too. This is a piece, Luna, from a performance that you'll see from 2018, Groundworks Dance Theater, and David Shimotakahara collaborating with the company on the choreography. We did the original version in 2013, and we did talk a lot about those sorts of things. The counterpoint in the sound for me has a lot to do with counterpoint between synthetic and real, even hyper real and virtual. Most of my music dwells more in the real side of things, but this piece has a lot of synthesized sounds and a lot of really heavily processed real world sounds that end up sounding synthetic or kind of virtual. And so that was a tension we were exploring. And then also I think internal versus external sound and movement. So I often think about this when composing for dance. What is the inner soundscape of the people on stage? If the audience member puts themselves in their place, what might they be hearing? And then what's the setting in which that's happening? So kind of almost like diegetic and non-diegetic sound in film or something like that. So and so the solo that this excerpt is the end of the piece. It's the very end of the piece. And it's Nicole Hennington, who's the featured soloist in the excerpt. And I think in her movement, you really see these sort of tensions of things that look natural and kind of real, and then things that look really stylized and sort of synthetic and hyper-real in ways that bodies might not always move. And I think hopefully the sound and the movement work together to highlight those features.
Okay, this piece is called Moving Through It, and it was directed by my wife, choreographer Holly Hanman Lopez. It was based on the surrealist game from 100 years ago, known as The Exquisite Corpse. The game was originally developed by poets and visual artists as a means of tapping into their collective subconscious.
Moving Through It is so striking for its celebration of different movement styles and your composition that glues all of the performer styles, locations, and timings together. It also seems like this piece has an extra special meaning of togetherness while we're distancing. So I have a few questions. How did this project come about, and what were the guidelines for the performers? Did they hear the music beforehand to have a common sound world to dance to, or were you inspired by the video compilation after it was assembled?
Right, good question. So In this realization of the exquisite corpse game, the dancers only saw the section before their own, so that they knew what pose to begin their movement with. And they did not hear the final music until after the video was totally edited. So I think there are a couple of interesting things about that approach. It might have made the various styles that you mentioned come out more strongly because there was no intended through line. So everybody's sort of individual and unique voice could really rise to the surface. At the same time though, I think that process provided opportunities for serendipitous moments to arise that were obviously unplanned. And what I like about that is it can illustrate perhaps unity has a way of shining through diversity.
And Tom, am I right in thinking that this was made after all of our students went home to their various home bases, wherever that was here in the spring of 2020?
Yeah. Actually, this is a brand new piece. It was just released last week, I believe, in fact. So there were 18 dancers, and all of them were spread out across the country. I think everybody was in the United States, but everybody was spread around the country. So you'll see some scenes that still have snow and inclement weather in them, and then other scenes that are clearly in very warm climates, some rural, some urban. As everybody is sort of dealing with that feeling of being spread out due to the pandemic that we're experiencing right now, the project was devised as one sort of attempt at helping people stay connected and finding a creative way to move through this.
In this excerpt of Valence, P Peter, your music creates such a cinematic and immersive landscape for the dancers to move in. For you, how does this arise? Is there a special relationship between the dancers' movements and how the sonic materials are generated, recorded, and performed? And relatedly, what are the discussions like in the collaborative process to create this synergy?
Yeah, thanks, Aurie. This was a piece that Amy Miller and I made together in 2009, originally for Groundworks Dance Theater in Cleveland. And the performance in this excerpt is by Gibney Dance Company in New York City, where Amy is now. And we spent a lot of time in conversation, in person, together when we made the piece, and talked a lot about a lot of really kind of key word concepts, just singular words that were our launching pad. And she would make some dance excerpts and I would make some sound excerpts, and we'd come back together and see how that was resonating with these sort of core ideas. And the one that kept emerging was this notion of it being very, very round points orbiting a center. There's a lot of circles in the piece and there are a lot of round sounds in the piece, a lot of bowl samples and other kind of metallic round resonant sounds. And I had an experience in a rehearsal with the company then that led me to some other sound worlds, because they were doing all of this running in circles, and every time they would run past me, the pages on my sketchbook would blow over and I'd flip them back. And I realized that even though I was seeing these circles until I had been in the space with them, I hadn't felt them. And then I really felt the wind and the motion of them going by. And so that led me to work with a lot of samples of wind and of things moving in the wind, a recording that I have from the mountains in Norway with my tent held up over my head with all the zippers and flaps flopping in the wind, and to do some things like convolution processing, where I would take that sample and convolve it with the bowl samples. So it was as if all those zippers and flaps were playing the bowl. And you hear a little bit about that in this excerpt here. So this is a 2018 performance, May 2018, Gibney Dance Company in New York City. Amy Miller is the choreographer.
So one of the pieces I'm sharing is brand new. This piece, on the other hand, Instruments of Faith, was one of my early pieces. This is, I think, from 1994. And it was choreographed by Brian Green in Austin, Texas, where I was working on my doctoral studies at the time. It was a very mysterious piece because the performance space was pitch black, except for a few light cans that were on the floor pointing straight up to the ceiling. So the dancers were crouched around the light cans in the dark, and then they would gradually appear when they leaned forward over the light source. So they could magically control their appearance from blackness and then simply recede back into the darkness again.
Yeah, it was fun to watch this, Tom, because unlike many of your dance pieces, I haven't seen this one live. I've had the good fortune to see a lot of them live here in Oberlin and elsewhere, but I was curious about this. I mean, obviously everything we're sharing here is on video, and video makes it, you know, so much easier to share this kind of work with the world. It's not the same as being there in person. And the video, I thought in this case, really got at this notion of dimensionality and how the visuals are so super close and intimate, but in a way that made me think of something very two-dimensional, much more like oil painting rather than sculpture. And I would imagine that even in the live performance, there was an element of that, having heard you describe how the lighting worked. So I was curious if you thought about your sound then teasing out a third dimension in relation to what the movement was doing visually.
Yeah, that's a really good question and a great observation, Peter. I would agree, actually, in the live performance, I think the visual aspect of the piece, of the performers, the shadows and how the light played on the textures of their skin and their faces did come across as fairly two-dimensional, certainly compared to what we normally think of as a dance performance that, you know, will often, you know, take place in the entire three-dimensional space that's available to the choreographer. But in the original performance, I did try to use the music to expand that. So there were speakers surrounding the audience, and the levels were pretty reasonable. I was younger at that point with healthier ears. So my hope at the time was that the sound would fully envelop the room and enhance a multidimensionality aspect of the space that the performance was occurring in. So the interesting thing then now, of course, is watching a video document of the piece is, of course, not the same as being there. The visual aspect is still perhaps rendered in, you know, two dimensions, even sort of emphasized by the screen that we're watching it on. And actually, I think perhaps the sound flips its role in this case. I'm imagining if people are listening to this, especially with headphones, and if you have some available, might be a good time to put on a pair. I wonder if the music for this piece actually reduces the sense of space and perhaps intensifies the more intimate and internal themes that the choreography explores.
This is an excerpt from Shifting Reflections, a collaboration with choreographer, dancer, and visiting assistant professor in the Oberlin Dance Department, Alice Blumenfeld. We performed this in March of 2020, right before we all dispersed from campus. So very special to me. We combined our practices in flamenco, contemporary belly dance, and buto to explore themes of memory, visual and sonic echoes, presence, distance, and the experience of embodied, imagined, and future nostalgia. The music is called Flutter, and it transforms many of the sounds produced from Alice's movements. For example, the falling flamenco skirt becomes a pattern of white noise. There are layers of the fan flutter using delay lines and reverberations of the flamenco shoe stomp.
Yeah, Aurie, this was, we all felt special about that concert, and this piece in particular was just incredible and such a pleasure to see live in that space, in our new theater space at Oberlin. I have lots of questions about this, but I'll stick with one, which is really about design, I think, because as people will see and hear, there's so much design in this piece. There's visual design, there's movement design, there's sonic design. And I think I say design in addition to composition because it seems so carefully crafted and so striking. I mean, the visual design in particular, with the costuming and with the kind of movement that you're doing is, you know, incredibly striking. And so I wonder about the relationship of those designs to each other in the piece, and maybe in particular the relationship between articulated gestures of sound or movement or visuals versus extended textures, things that go on for a long time rather than have a precise kind of articulation.
Yeah, thank you so much for those kind words. It was especially special because we were all there together and it was a fantastic concert. I'm wondering, as I'm thinking about how to answer that question, and I'm thinking maybe the answer lies in how we developed the piece. And we developed the piece over the course of about 6 months. And probably the first 4 months were improvisation sessions that we recorded. So we have hours of video recording of us holding poses and you know, holding poses or repeating a movement over and over for quite a long time. And then in order to construct the piece and put these components together, we reviewed the video, chopped out portions that we loved, and either compressed how long they took to do or expanded them. And so I wonder if that might have a direct correlation to what you experience as the held moments and then the more textural transition moments. And I think when we constructed the piece, we did find moments of visual patterns that we both loved, that we wanted to be, you know, here's a moment that we hold and articulate, and then here's a moment that is more about transience, or, you know, it's ethereal, and the timing can be flexible depending on how we feel. So I love that you picked up on that overarching form of, you know, held time, and then the times where we're moving between those pillars or those landmarks.
Thank you.
Thank you for everybody who's been watching and listening. It's been a pleasure for me to spend some virtual time with my colleagues, sharing our work with each other and with the greater world. This in particular has been a very exciting year for us. We are celebrating 50 years of electronic music at Oberlin Conservatory. The first classes were taught here in 1969 by Ollie Wilson and John Clow. And we had a really fabulous year celebrating this in the fall. Our colleague and TIMARA engineer Abby Oresti hosted a symposium where we had some incredible performers and guests on campus. Then in November, we had the Kaleidosonic Music Festival with over 500 musicians in Finney Chapel and a huge audience, food trucks, and hours of musical collage. And then this spring, we had some additional events celebrating our 50th year. The students had a sonic and musical, actually in video as well, rendition of An Exquisite Corpse in Fairchild Chapel under the direction of Aurie Hsu. And then the TIMARA faculty were blessed to have access to the new Wurzel Theater, where our colleague Eli Stein developed and implemented a 24-speaker array that fully surrounded the audience and allowed us the opportunity to diffuse sound in really powerful and wonderful ways. That was also the event where Ari's piece, Shifting Reflections, was premiered with Alice. And we had another one scheduled that unfortunately was canceled. We had an evening of film and live music planned for the Apollo Theater here in Oberlin. I hope that we'll revisit that event someday. And then finally, I just want to mention that the kinds of work that you've seen, the music that you've heard, and the things that you've heard us talk about in this session are all things that our students are working on as well. And in fact, they're doing it at a very high level, and I'm so honored to be able to work with them because I learned so much from their creativity and their ingenuity and their technical expertise. It's really an honor for me to be able to work with TIMARA majors on an ongoing basis.
Also, we want to remind you to please stay tuned as we'll roll the credits of all our incredible collaborators from across the globe. So please stay tuned for those. Thanks for tuning in.
Thank you, everybody. There'll be other events coming up, other TIMARA events to stay tuned for, as Tom mentioned, and we're so glad you joined us tonight. Be well. Thanks very much.